Okay, so let's carry on. So today what we're going to do is we're going to tackle the topic, always be prepared to listen. And we're going to look at three different aspects. This topic is really so huge, we could spend 3 weeks talking about this, 1 week on each topic. So what I'd like to do this morning is kind of move quickly through the first two, and we'll get to the last one that I think perhaps is the most important. I want to tell you a story about Marty. Marty and his brother were talking, and Marty's brother said to him, are you and your wife okay? Said, you guys seem to be having some difficulties. And Marty said, no, things aren't going well. And so his brother said, well, you know, what's up? He said, well, my wife's always complaining. And he said, well, what's her complaint? And Marty says, well, she complains that I never listen, or something like that, okay? And some of us may have experienced that in our lives as well. Let me tell you about another chap. His name was John. John was kind of old school. He was retired. He was a widower. Wore his hair down to his shoulders, had a beard and a mustache. And John was feeling kind of isolated. And the reason he was feeling isolated is he realized that his hearing wasn't what it used to be. And oftentimes things were said that he never caught on to. The television was never up loud enough. The family seemed to be getting a little antsy for him asking them constantly to repeat things. John lived with his oldest daughter and her husband and the kids. His brother lived down the street with his family. And despite having all that family close by, he was feeling really isolated. So what John decided to do was to go to an audiologist, and they put him in the box, and they tested his hearing and had him repeat all the words that he could repeat, and they fitted him with a hearing aids, and he was astounded. He could hear stuff that he hadn't been able to hear for years, and so they sent him home and said, look, come back in a month, and we'll see how you're doing. We have to fine-tune those things a little bit. We'll do that. So John went home, came back a month later. Audiologist said, how are things going? He said, wonderful. He said, I can hear absolutely everything. And he said, wow, the audiologist said, your family must really be pleased. And he said, well, they don't know. He said, I never told them. And he said, with my long hair, he said, no one's twigged to the fact that I'm wearing hearing aids. And he said, well, why'd you do that? And he said, oh, he said, I've just kind of sat back for the last month and kind of listened to understand. He said, I've changed my will 3 times, he said. So today we're going to talk about always be prepared to listen and understand other people. Over the years, I've done a bit of counseling for couples who are in difficulty, and I'm sure that we have 3 people here that have done the same type of thing. And there always seems to be a common denominator. Either people don't communicate well, or finances seem to be an issue. Most likely it's because they don't communicate well about the finances. So one little exercise that I've tried with couples that seem to work okay was get the couples talking to each other and ask one of them, so let's say I ask the husband, to say, tell me what you think the issue in your marriage is. And so this chap one time mentioned, well, we have set a goal of 5 years to have enough saved for down payment for a house. So we have decided this is the amount of money that we have to save every month to do that, and we live on a really, really tight budget. The problem is, my wife likes to buy clothes. And whenever there's a sale on, she's there. And when it comes time at the end of the month for us to put that money aside, there's never enough money. And my concern is, we're never going to be able to buy a house because we won't have enough for a down payment. So then what I would do is I would ask the wife to tell me what he just said. And her response was, he doesn't want me to buy any clothes. As I said, no, tell her again. Repeat what he said. So went back over, told the whole story again about the budget and not having enough for down payment. And then I asked her again, tell me what he just said. And she said, well, he would rather I just buy my clothes at Value Village or Talese. And we had to go through that exercise a number of times till finally she understood that he was concerned that they weren't saving enough money to get a down payment for a house. She wasn't listening to what he said. And we do that all the time. All the time. And it causes huge difficulties in marriages and relationships. It derails relationships. It degrades our self-image. It detours our relationship with God. Not listening well and understanding well can cost huge amount of money. How many times have we heard of people who wanted renovations done to their house and somebody wasn't listening, either the contractor or the homeowner, when they talked about all those things, and what they got was not what they wanted, and it cost more money. So sometimes listening can cost a lot of money. If you're a student and you don't listen well when an instructor is talking about an exam, you may wind up with lower marks. And I've been with students where that has happened when I was in Bible college. I remember one of the instructors saying, look, most of the marks are for the first three questions and the last two. If you think, read through them all before you do anything. If you think you aren't going to get through the exam, do the first three, the last two, and then fill in the rest. And a number of students afterwards complained, I didn't have enough time. I only got halfway through. And the other students would say, well, you did the last two, didn't you? Well, no, nobody mentioned anything about that. So they didn't listen, cost them marks, okay? Same thing with sales opportunities. If you're in the business of sales, you need to listen well and understand what your customer wants. We had a clip here. And before we show that clip, if we can get it working here, what I want you to do is everybody from here over, okay? You're going to listen to this clip, and this is a Big Bang clip. And so Amy, she is going to display some really active listening skills, okay? A little over the top, but she's got them. So that's your job this morning, right? From Chris right over, okay? And afterwards, you need to tell me what she did. This group over here, you're the Sheldon people. Sheldon is not listening well, okay? So you're going to tell me what he doesn't do or what he does is poor listening skills. So hopefully this is going to work. So away we go.
First there was PlayStation, aka PS1. Then there's PS2, PS3, and now PS4. And that makes sense. You'd think after Xbox, there'd be Xbox 2. But no. Next came Xbox 360. Hmm? And now, after 360, comes Xbox One. Why one? Maybe that's how many seconds of thought they put into naming it.
Can you get the butter, please?
Yeah. However, with the Xbox One, I can control my entire entertainment system using voice commands. Up until now, I've had to use Leonard.
Then get the other one. Pass the butter.
Hang on. I don't feel like you're taking this dilemma seriously.
Fine, Sheldon. You have my undivided attention.
Okay, now, the PS4 is more angular and sleek looking.
No way!
It's true. But the larger size of the Xbox One may keep it from overheating.
Well, you wouldn't want your gaming system to overheat.
No, see, well, you absolutely would not. And furthermore, the Xbox One now comes with a Kinect included.
Included?
Yes. Not sold separately. Although the PS4 uses cool new GDDR5 RAM, while the Xbox One is still using the conventional DDR3 memory.
Why would they still be using DDR3? Are they nuts?
See, that's what I thought. But then they go and throw in an ES RAM buffer.
Whoa, wait a second. Who's they?
The Xbox.
You're kidding!
No, I am not! And this ES RAM buffer should totally bridge the 100 gigabit per second bandwidth gap between the two RAM types.
This is a nightmare! How will you ever make a decision?
You see, I don't know. What should I do?
Please pass the butter!
Okay. So, this group over here, And we're going to get Scott to run the mic around so everybody can hear, and so the people who are listening on YouTube later can understand what was going on. So stick your hand up. Suggestions on what did Amy do really, really well that displayed active listening, okay? And if you don't stick your hand up, I'll pick a few. Okay, here we go. Right at the back and then down at the front here. So what was Amy doing? Okay, the mic's not on. Turn the mic on.
She asked for, she asked for clarification, so she was like, who's they?
Okay, all right, so she asked for clarification, okay?
Same sort of thing, engaged in eye contact?
Sure, if you watched it, at one point she put her elbows on the table and she leaned forward. She was really, really engaged. Okay, there's a whole bunch of them now. What are some of the others? Paul?
She repeated what he said.
Okay, she played back what he said, absolutely. And that's important, because sometimes we play it back, we don't get it right. Okay, John? Okay. The other John.
She got excited about what he was talking about.
Sure, she was engaged. She was really excited. Okay? Any other thoughts? Oh, we got a few more than that. Yes. Here's one of our counselors.
Brad. She reflected not just content, but she reflected how he was feeling.
Okay.
So when she said things like, you have got to be kidding, she was actually reflecting back to him his shock.
Absolutely. Pass it over to Cheryl because she's got a comment too.
she's got all the good ones.
Okay. Any others? Okay. What did Sheldon not do when you watched that whole thing? Or what did he do that displayed poor listening skills?
He absolutely did not engage with her.
What was he most interested in? But he was most interested in talking, not listening, okay? What are some other things that happen? Okay? Help this group over here. Help out. What did Sheldon not do? Okay, listening, obviously. He got that she wanted the butter. He went and he got the butter, and then he sat it down like he just dismissed what she was after. Amy. Got it. All right. There's a whole bunch of things that we can learn if we are willing to observe when people are talking and when people are listening. And in Sheldon's case, probably his biggest error was he was more interested in talking than he was in listening. And when we engage other people, if the only thing that we're interested in is what we have to say, we totally miss what other people are doing. Amy was absolutely engaged. And I don't multitask well when it comes to listening. I just don't do it well. And if we're driving along in the car, I like to listen to CBC or a talk show or something like that. And if I'm listening to that and Pauline starts to talk to me, I've got a problem because I can't multitask well enough to listen to what the interviewer is saying and to listen to Pauline. So I got a choice to make, okay? One choice is not healthy, okay? So I found my best bet is to, no matter how interesting the radio is to turn it off. Otherwise, I get stuck in the middle and I don't catch the conversation on the interview well and I'm in trouble with my wife, okay? So if we're going to listen well to others, we need to pay attention, we need to avoid any distractions, and give them our total attention. And when we do that, we avoid misunderstandings. When we listen well enough to understand what the other person is trying to tell us, we have the potential to learn a lot about them, and we also have the potential to improve our relationships. And it doesn't matter if it's our relationships with each other, with God, whatever, we have this potential to improve our relationships. Next one I want to talk about is always be prepared to understand your self-talk. And Tyler did a great job 2 weeks ago. He talked about that and he explained that sometimes our negative thoughts can have a negative influence on our lives. And the opposite is true. If our self-talk and how we talk about ourselves to others is positive, then it has a bearing on our lives. psychologist at the University of Massachusetts said this. Dr. Susan Krause Whitborn is her name. And she said, the more we talk ourselves down, second guess ourselves, and see change as calamitous, the less free our minds will be to roam through the creative solutions to the problems that we face. She says we need to nip dysfunctional self-talk in the butt. We need to find it, we will find it much easier not only to inspire others, but to inspire ourselves. Our small group did a series a little while ago called Pause. And I remember one of the things that Andy Stanley, he's the one that was teaching on the DVD, and one of the things that Stanley said is that we need to stop and we need to consider what we're saying to ourselves in every situation. We need to examine our self-talk because sometimes our self-talk can take us to places that are not healthy for us. Craig Groeschel is another pastor, well-known pastor, and he said that because of our negative self-talk, it can be so debilitating that we need to ask ourselves two questions every day. And he said the same as Andy Stanley. He said, we need to stop, and we need to pause, and we need to understand what we are saying to ourselves and about ourselves. And so he said, we need to ask ourselves two questions every day. Number one is, what negative thoughts are influencing or hindering my life? Okay, what negative thoughts are influencing or hindering my life? And the second one is, what spiritual truths can set me free from those strongholds? So he asks himself that every day. And then what he does is when he understands what negative self-talk is there, he writes down some positive declarations. Okay, and then he not only writes them down, but he reads them out loud. He does that at the start of every day. It's an exercise he's found that works for him. And here's some examples of some of the things that he writes down and he says to himself every day because he wants to pump positive stuff in. He said, this is one of them. He said, Jesus is first in my life and I exist to serve him. Okay? He says, one of the other statements he had, he said, I love my wife and I will lay down my life to serve her. Because of Jesus, he said, I'm a child of God. And he's got that from Galatians 3 and 26. I'm a new creation is one of the things that he writes down. And he says to himself to help him understand that now that Christ is in his life, he is different than he was before. And he doesn't have to have those negative self-thoughts that were there before. And some of those negative self-thoughts and the self-talk we have, I like to call them woe is me words, okay? And they're things that we will say to ourselves or think in the back of our minds, and sometimes we do it over and over again. We think, well, I could never do that. Nobody is interested in what I have to say. How is that possible in my life? No one cares about me. And there's a whole bunch of those things that are woe is me words. And if we can kind of purge those from our mind and say things like, I'm a new creation, God will help me through this, then things can change. And we can change. And I've talked to, as we were doing our sermon planning on this, we could spend a whole session here on why we think the way we do and where all those influences came. And we don't have time for that today. But there is some things that we can do to turn our self-talk around. So first of all, when we listen to others and to understand them, we avoid misunderstandings, and relationships are improved. When you and I listen to understand our self-talk, you and I can identify some debilitating things that we say about ourselves, either to ourselves or we say those things to other people, and we can get ourselves to become more positive. Now the one that I want us to spend a little more time on is this one, is always be prepared to understand what God is saying. And in Scripture, when we come across the words hear and listen, they often mean understanding the truth of what is being said firmly enough to step in and act on it. Okay, let me read that again. When we hear the words hear or listen in Scripture, those often mean to understand the truth of what is being stated firmly enough to move into it. And here's some of the what Scripture has to say. If we go way back in Proverbs, it said, ears to hear and eyes to see, both are gifts from God. So God has prepared us to understand His will. God has prepared us to not only hear with our ears, but to read what He says in Scripture and to be encouraged and changed and improved by that. Scott talked last week about the transformation where Peter, James, and John were with Jesus on the mountain, and all of a sudden this cloud rolled in, and this voice, loud, loud voice from the cloud said, "This is my dearly beloved Son, whom I am well pleased. Listen to him. Listen to him." So listening in Scripture is often meant to mean understanding the truth of what is being said firmly enough to step into it and incorporate it in our lives. If you read at all about Jesus, you know that a lot of times when he was teaching, he told stories. They're called parables. And a number of the parables that he told, he'd get to the end of the parable, and here's what he'd say. He said, "Anyone with ears to hear, let him listen and understand. Let him listen and understand." Jesus said these words also. He said, "I tell you the truth, that those who listen to my message and believe in God who sent me have eternal life. They will never be condemned for their sins, but they have already passed from death to life." Huge concern for Jesus was the fact that we don't listen, that we don't get it. And he talked about that time and time again. And it's not new. Back in the Old Testament, one of God's prophets, Zechariah, had this to say. He said, "Your ancestors refused to listen to this message." And what he was talking about was a message of encouragement on how we treat each other and how we relate to each other. He said, "Your ancestors refused to listen to this message. They stubbornly turned away and they put their fingers in their ears." Like, what a great visual of us not listening well to someone else. They turned away and they stuck their fingers in the ear. How many of you have had kids who have done exactly that? Okay, put their head down, put their finger in their ear, and the next step is to go, "Yeah, yeah, 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 yeah," so they can't hear at all, okay? And here's a prophet of God saying, that's what you do. He said they made their hearts as hard as stone so they could not hear instructions or the messages that the Lord of Heaven's army had sent to them by his Spirit through the earlier prophets. If we had to look at those three things, how do we listen to understand to other people? How do we listen to our self-talk so that we can become more positive? And then how do we listen to understand God? On the surface, I'd suggest to you that maybe the first two might be easier. Okay, it's fairly easy to listen if we put our mind to it, to listen to other people, to make sure we're not distracted, to do all the active listening things. When it comes to listening to ourselves, unless we're standing in front of a mirror, we can't see the body language, but we can use some of those same techniques to listen well. The advantage we have of our self-talk is often we repeat it over and over and over again, so it's easier to pick up on. But listening to God is different. And my suggestion to you today is that listening to God is easier than you think it might be. Listening to Jesus with a goal to understanding of who he is and what he is about is often easier than most of us might think. I like reading biographies. This is the latest one I'm reading. This is Joe Gibbs. If you're a sports fan, you'll know that Joe Gibbs coached the Washington Redskins to 3 victories. He is now a NASCAR race owner, owns a number of racing teams, and have been very, very successful. He's a committed Christian, and he wrote this book called The Game Plan for Life. Fascinating book. And as I read through here, I've been able to kind of understand Joe Gibbs better. better than I have from the interviews that were on television or whatever. And it has helped me understand who he is, how he thinks, and what he's about. Scripture does the same thing. If we look in the New Testament, there's four biographies of Jesus. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. They all have a little different flavor, but their biographies help us to understand exactly who he is. If you go on and read some of the letters that follow after that, you'll find that there's some explanations of how you live out what he taught. If you go back into the Older Testament, you will find in the book of Proverbs, you can read through, there's instructions for, if you read those, two or three every day on how to live life. And yes, we're reading, but that's why we have ears to hear and eyes to see. If you don't have a Bible, and you should have one, go to the library table over there, and there's some Bibles on the table there. Take one, okay? We don't want anyone not to have a Bible. One of the things that was mentioned when we said, what did Amy do well when she was active listening, and one was ask questions. And we need to do that. Whenever we read Scripture, we need to ask questions. One of the most helpful things that I have found is a study Bible. So it's got all the Scripture in the top part of the page. The bottom part of the page is where some people who are experts, theologians, have helped us understand what was being said. There's an area there where you can look at the history. Why was that letter written? Why would the people say that? Why would they say what they did? And I looked it up on Amazon. And you can buy one of these for $45, which to me is a tremendous investment. And I've got this one pretty well worn because I use it so much. So how do we listen to what God has to say? How do we listen to what Jesus has to say? Well, it's a different type of listening. You and I can read Scripture, then we need to ask questions and use a lot of the skills that we would when we talk to each other. You can't read Scripture while you're watching television. It just doesn't work. You can't read Scripture when you're texting someone else. It doesn't work. It doesn't work any more than it works when you're trying to talk to someone else. Number of years ago, my sister was with her daughter in a restaurant. They were having lunch together, and Susan looked up, and there was Emma texting. And so Susan reached into her purse and pulled out a pocketbook. And she started to read her pocketbook, and when Emma was done her texting, she looked up and she said, "Mom, that's kind of rude." And she didn't get it. And you can't do two things at the same time. You can't listen and do something else at the same time. And that's true when we try to listen to what God's Word has to say to us. We can't be watching television. We need to find a time where we avoid all the distractions and we get together with Him. And Jesus told us at one time, he said, "I'm going to send the Holy Spirit, and he will guide you into all truth." So it's not just us that's trying to understand. He sent his Holy Spirit to help us understand as we read, what does that mean? How does that apply to our own lives? And I've had times when I have read the same scripture probably 20 times before, and I've been dealing with something in my life, and all of a sudden I read that scripture again, and it clicks. And there's something in that scripture that applies exactly to the situation that I'm dealing with. And so God can speak to us easily through his word. We have people like myself and Scott Wheeler and Scott Pierce and Tyler who've been called by God to try to help us understand how do we hear from God? What is God saying to us, and how does that affect our lives? And then you and I have this incredible privilege of praying to God. And there is no timetable for that. We can stop at any point because God always listens and he's always there. And then there'll be times when God will communicate directly to you and me. Now, let me clarify that. I have never, ever heard God's audible voice But I have been a follower of Christ long enough to know when God is communicating with me. Let me give you some examples. Too bad that Craig and his Foster and his wife are not here today. At least I don't think they're here. Years ago, when I was on staff at Calvary Church, I sensed God talking to me that I should phone Craig's dad, Phil, that he needed to be encouraged. And I thought, well, maybe this evening I'll do that. And it was like there was someone rapping on the door to get my attention. Said, no, it's now. You need to do that now. Well, I knew where Phil worked. He was a produce manager in a grocery store. And I didn't even know if he could receive calls or if he would get in trouble receiving calls. But I couldn't shake it. And so when God speaks, you're very, very wise to follow what he said. So got the phone number for the store, phoned up, asked if I could talk to Phil. And I said, Phil, this may sound goofy, but I really think that God wanted me to phone and talk with you today. Is everything okay? And I could hear him suck his breath in. And when he talked to me, his voice was really shaky. And he said, Dave, he said, I'm going through a terrible time. And so I listened for a while and we prayed together. And his parting words were, you will never know how important this phone call is right now. He said, I needed to hear that God cares and that you care. That's God talking to us, okay? More recently, with our small group, we were listening to a series where the teaching that evening was about being generous and how we can step into the lives of other people. And right in the middle of that small group session, I sensed that God was communicating. Didn't hear an audible voice, but it was so powerful that I could not concentrate, and maybe it's part of the thing that I don't multitask well, but I could not concentrate on the DVD and the teaching we were watching. I was lost for about 10 or 15 minutes and finally said to the group, I believe God has been talking to me and here's a situation I'm aware of. And I think, at least for Pauline and I, that we need to step into this situation, that we need to be generous. And I don't know if that means God is talking to everyone in our group or just us. So we stopped the small group. And I just have to give credit to Diane and John who lead our small group. They led us in prayer. And we decided to do something, to step into a need, and we made it happen. And it was simply God leading and God speaking and us listening to understand what God would have us to do. And if you can build your relationship firm enough with Jesus Christ, if you can take the time to understand, get alone and understand what he's saying in his Bible, if you will listen carefully, if you will allow the Holy Spirit to communicate with you, then you can listen well enough to God to understand what he's saying and then simply to step into it. And folks, it's unbelievable. Absolutely what God can use us to do that we would never ever have dreamed of before. So let's go back. Be willing to do whatever is necessary to make us better and to have things go better. Being better prepared involves change and adjustment. If there's no change, there'll be no adjustment. If you leave here today and you're talking with your spouse or talking with your kids or talking with your neighbors and you don't do anything different than you did have been doing so far, nothing will change. But if you've picked up on some active listening skills today, things will be different. If you can get to listen to yourself talk, how you talk to yourself, how you talk about yourself to others, and decide today, when I do that, I'm going to stop and I'm going to change my vocabulary. Instead of saying, I can't do that, I could never do that, to simply say, you know what? I think I could. I teach a number of people to carve, okay? over the years, I've taught some seminars. I have a couple of kids that come on an ongoing basis. And the three-year words that I use often, frequently, for those is, you can do it. I'll show them a step, and I'll say, you can do it. And we need to tell ourselves that. I can do it. I may not be perfect, but I can do it. And we can change how we think about ourselves. When we listen to understand what God has to say with a goal of understanding His will, He can use us for things that we have never, ever dreamed of. He can step into our lives and there'll be change. Listening to God means understanding the truth of what He is being said firmly enough to move on it. Listening to God means understanding His truth firmly enough that we're willing to step into it and incorporate it in our lives. Father, this is a huge topic that we've tackled today. This whole idea of listening well to each other, this whole idea of, and the scary thing about listening to ourselves with the understanding that we can change things around, and most importantly, help us that we would learn to listen to you better than we ever have before, that we would understand what Scripture is saying, that we would make the effort to be alone and spend time with you, that we would ask questions, that we would hear the small voice of your Holy Spirit speaking in our lives. Father, let us leave here today being better listeners to each other so we understand each other, better listeners to ourselves so that we understand ourselves better, and better listeners to you so that we can understand you and your ways better. And we just ask it in Christ's name. Amen. We're going to pass the baskets around. First ones that come around, you take stuff out of. And things like, there'll be some sheet in there if you want to be on our email list and receive some information and some reminders about what's coming up. You can also take out the brown envelopes for your offering. Then the second basket that comes around, they're the ones that you can put stuff into. And if you're a guest with us today, we certainly don't expect you to contribute in the offering. You're our guest. If you decide to be here on a regular basis, then certainly you can help with expenses. We're going to have some time for a question and answer, and Scott's going to run the mic around. So questions about listening to others with a goal to understand, or some comments or some suggestions that you might have. Okay, way over here. Right up to your chin.
How do you, when you're with somebody that talks all the time, constantly, you're having a coffee or something, and you can't, the only way you can say anything is to interrupt, which is extremely rude. How do you politely tell them that you would like to be their friend, but part of conversation is you talk, I talk?
Okay. I'm going to pass the mic here to Brad and Cheryl, okay? Because I'm sure they deal with this all the time. So what happens if you're a talker, an incessant talker? How what do you do with that?
Well, one of the things I've been taught to do is to shift away from the content of the conversation and focus on the process, and just say, "I noticed that you really love to talk, and I'm doing lots of listening here, but I'm also getting the feeling like there's not really much room for me to say anything here and to respond. And I'm wondering, are you wanting any feedback from me, or you know?" So the content, you know, as long as we stay in the content, usually the process continues to be the same, and it might feel like a bit of a tug of war as we're trying to get in. So just shifting the focus to the process. I don't know, that's
okay.
Typically
right.
What I do.
Okay, Cheryl's gonna correct Brad now.
No. Just to add to, I think we can maybe possibly take different roles in relationships. For example,
there are people that I go and spend time with, and they do talk more of the time, but I see that more as my ministry time. I'm kind of listening to them and offering them support. But if it's a friendship, there has to be some evenness there. And okay. So if this continues on where the other person continues to not listen to you or not hear you saying, you know, what needs to be more even, it kind of lets us know that they're not really interested in having a relationship. They're more interested in having an audience. So then we can make choices around how much time do I want to spend with somebody who isn't really interested in having a relationship with me.
Wow, sage advice, sage advice. Any other questions or comments down at the front? One of the things that Brad said that I think is really, really important, and I have to remind myself of this when Pauline is talking, or when Pauline's talking and I'm trying to listen. I'm a problem solver. I love to solve problems. I like to identify something that's not working well and step into it and fix it. That's my nature. Okay. When Pauline tells me some things, I often have to say to her, do you want me just to listen, or do you want me to do something? And most of the time, Pauline does not want me to do anything. She just wants to explain how she's feeling or whatever. And if I try to fix her, it doesn't go well. Okay? And so that's an important thing. Okay.
Maybe because I listen to a lot of people, I have to prepare for that. So what I usually do is, in order to have that happen, is that I let them know, look, I have 5 minutes for you, and that what that it prepares them to know that there's a time limit on how much time they can talk, so to get their point across to me, and it still allows them to feel like I'm including them and that I'm not brushing them off. So preparing by giving them a time limit.
Okay, all right, good suggestion. Okay, some other thoughts or some questions? Good thoughts and good questions. Can we run the quote show? Do you think that'll work? We're going to try that. Oops, we got one more. Oh, there we go. Your head. Are you? The water so deep, you're drowning. Do you think you've been? To feel you're hurting. Well, everybody has been there, and everybody's felt lost. If you're in over your head, lift it up. We're going to get Neil to pick a name out of the hat. Okay, John Potter, you have brought your mug today. And we have a card for you at Starbucks. Why don't we stand this morning and Neil's going to lead us in worship.
Lord, you have my heart, and I will search for yours. Jesus, take my life and lead me on.
Lord, you have my heart.
Lord, you have my heart, and I will search for yours. Let me be to you a sacrifice,
and I will praise.
And I will praise you, Lord. And I will sing of love come down. And as you show your face,
back to top. Lord, you have my heart.
Lord, you have my heart, and I will search for yours. Jesus, take my life and lead me on. Lord, you have my heart, I will search for yours. Let me be to you a sacrifice,
and I will praise.
And I will praise you, Lord. And I will sing of love come down. And as you show your face, we'll see